Good afternoon. It's a pleasure, of course, to be with each and every one of you here this afternoon to honor our brother as has passed. Let me start with his little bit of his information. Raymond Lee Wine Jr., age 57, of Elizabeth City, North Carolina, died on Sunday, March the 12th, 2023, at Sentara Albemarle Hospital. He was born in San Diego, California, on August the 30th, 1965, to Virginia Sadler Wine and the late Raymond Lee Wine, Sr. He was the husband of Angela Wine. Raymond Lee recently received from the Department of, from the Department of Defense as an HVAC technician, where he served for the last 35 years. He was a member of the Mason Lodge in Camden, Widow's Son Lodge, number 75, AF and AM. The Softball Nation and Elizabeth City Rec Department League umpire. Raymond loved sports and was an avid Dallas Cowboys and Atlanta Braves fan, as well as a UNC Tar Heels fan. In addition to his spouse and mother, he is survived by two sons, Dakota Wine of Elizabeth City, Johnny Wine of Elizabeth City, a sister, Debbie Moody of Ogden, Utah, three grandchildren, Skylar, Chloe, and Zoe, an aunt, Donna Curlings, a niece, Yvette, Gavin, and a nephew, Guy Gilbert. So let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll have a song that's been chosen that's very befitting to today's service. Father, I come to you today and ask for your wisdom. I ask for your guidance. I ask for Holy Spirit's leading as we conduct this service today, that it will bring you honor, and it will bring honor to our brother that has gone on to be with you. Father, I pray for the family that they will be given peace that passes understanding. Your loving arms be around each and every one, and they would rest in your hands and in your arms. Father, let them learn not to just hold on, but to let go and be held by you. We look forward to your blessings today, my Lord. In Christ's name, amen.
Far side of the sky, the first thing that I'm gonna do is spread my wings and fly. I'm gonna land beside a lion and run my fingers through his mane, or I might find out what it's like to ride a drop of rain. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, don't cry for me down. Gonna walk with my granddaddy, and he'll match me step for step. And I'll tell him how I've missed him every minute since he left. And then I'll hug his neck. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears. I will shed the sins and struggles I have carried all these years, and I'll leave my heart wide open. I will love and have no fear. Yeah, when I
these questions I can't answer. So much work to do. But when I get where I'm going, and I see my Maker's face, I'll stand forever in the light of His amazing grace. Yeah, when I get where I'm going, oh, when I get where I'm going, there'll be only happy tears.
You know, at times like these, we tend to ponder on our own mortality a little bit, don't we? One day, it may be my name on that bulletin. It's going to be one day when they will be yours. Your family and friends will be gathered around hurting and mourning the loss of a loved one. When you get where you're going, will they know where you are? Question to ponder for today. See, Raymond Lee lived his whole life to be where he is today, and will do the same. He was born on August the 30th of 1965, and he was promoted on March the 12th of 2023. Yes, promoted. You see, when a child of God moves from this world to a world where there's no more pain, no more suffering, and into the eternal reward in the presence of the Lord, folks, that's a promotion. We need to understand that. We need to know that. We need to own that. Now, I think as Raymond Lee came up to the gates of heaven, I think he might have been distracted a little and looked off to the side and saw a great and mighty junkyard. Now, most folks never thought much about a junkyard right outside the gates of heaven, have you? But you see, when we get there, we don't need the stuff of this world. It's going to be a pile of wheelchairs, a pile of walkers, a pile of crutches, false teeth, eyeglasses, false knees, pacemakers, all kind of stuff just thrown to the side because we don't need them anymore. As these things are left behind and we approach the gates of heaven, God's going to give us a new body, a new heart, an eternal body, and we enter into the kingdom of God where there's no pain, there's no suffering. Because heaven's where God is, and that stuff cannot exist in the presence of a holy God. So why do I say Raymond Lee saw the junk pile? I call him Raymond Lee because I worked with his mama so long, that's what she called him. A lot of people call him Ray, or a lot of different things, but I'll refer to him a lot as Raymond Lee. Why do I say that he saw the junk pile? Because based on his profession of faith in Jesus Christ, when he joined the church many years ago, and based on the unchangeable truths of Scripture, like and many of them, but just say like John 3:16, where it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Put your name in there, because you are a whosoever. Raymond Lee was a whosoever. I'm a whosoever. Whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God had, by his own choosing, saved him based on that profession. So was Ray a perfect saint? Certainly not. If there's one here today, I'd like to meet you, because neither are you, you know? None of us are a perfect saint. If we were perfect, we could walk into the presence of a holy God based on our own righteousness. But since the sin of Adam, that hasn't happened. The righteousness of man was lost, and sin entered the world, and sin separated us with God, separated us from God. And since that time, only one, pure, holy, and righteous, has walked this earth, and that's Jesus Christ. That separation from God caused us to need two things. That's redeeming and reconciling. Okay, that's two big words that have a simple meaning. Redeeming means we need to be paid for. Our sins have got to be paid for. Jesus Christ did that with his own blood on the cross of Calvary. Reconciling means that that needs to be brought before God to bring us back in fellowship with God. And he done that when he raised up from the dead, and he walked into heaven to prepare a place for us in the presence of his Father. It's that simple. About the time the family moved here to North Carolina, Raymond Lee joined Sawyers Creek Baptist Church, and there it was then pastored by Brother Tom LeGrand, and Raymond Lee enjoyed serving there with Pastor LeGrand and did mission trips and those kind of things throughout the years. He later joined Berea Baptist Church, where he served in several capacities through several years with Pastor Greenway, and more recently as a member at Forest Park Baptist Church. See, Raymond Lee was born naturally to his mother and his father, Miss Virginia Wine and Mr. Raymond Lee Wine. But I don't know if you know that Raymond Lee was also adopted. Now, don't get mad at me just yet. You see, the difference between born and adopted is a matter of choice. You see, Mr. Ray and Miss Virginia had a son, and they took what they got. They didn't have a choice. The son that came to them was given, and they didn't have a choice on what it was or anything else. They loved him, they cherished him, they worked their hardest, and they raised him right, and they sent him forth into the world to make a difference in this world. But God adopted him. God chose him and said, I want him. And I'll purchase him with the precious blood of my own son. You see, when a family adopts a child, it's by choice, and it's not free. It costs. Well, it costs God the blood of his son. So you see, he was chosen. He was purchased at a great price. He was taught and led by God to make a difference in this world. He never stopped being the son of Raymond and Virginia. Excuse me, in Virginia, but he started being a born-again son of God. We have comfort from the scriptures found in Psalm 23, and I'll read that. And I know you've heard it 100 times, if not 1,000, but let it sink in. Let it give you the peace and the comfort that it's intended to. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Peace, comfort from the 23rd Psalm. Now, if I've spent some time around the last few days, I listened and learned from a lot of his friends that Ray was very good at sports. Although he was never a small person, he was good at baseball, softball, basketball, football, and yes, even bowling. Ray was good at all sports. He put himself into it, whatever he was doing, and he was good at it. And this is what was said. It said, you always wanted to be on his team for two reasons. One, he was just that good of a player. And two, he had a mama that was the best cheerleader you ever seen. And she didn't mind fighting umpires for you. Ray's friends also spoke of the many times they gathered at his home to hang out, to play sports or other activities as they were coming along. And she said, Miss Virginia and Mr. Ray always welcomed his friends like they were their own children. You see, most of us have experienced that welcoming, haven't we? A family that becomes our family when we're around them just a little while because they love people, they're good to people. Raymond Lee, also known as Sugar Bear to some, he enjoyed leading and guiding and teaching young people. And he did this relentlessly in the Softball Nation League and in the Elizabeth City Recreational League as an umpire for many, many years. And he touched many lives and he made many friends. As I said earlier, he was a big fan of UNC and he loved the Tar Heels. He also thought the world of the Dallas Cowboys and the Atlanta Braves and I'm sure many other teams, but they're the ones that I know about. As I can see attested by some of the attire that people have on today, a lot of time when you saw him, you saw matching tennis shoes, shorts, shirt, and a hat that supported that team. And you know, not many people go that far. A lot of them will put on a hat, will put on a shirt, but that was coordinated. When you saw it, you knew he was in total support. And what he did, he was in total support of. He was good at it because he poured himself into it. Ray loved his family. He loved his mother, Virginia. He loved his father, Ray. I remember preaching Mr. Ray's funeral and how Raymond Lee took care of Miss Virginia through that time. I remember him just doing everything she needed, being right there for her every minute, and he took good care of her. His sister, Debbie, found a special place in his heart. I learned last night they got to spend some time together before his passing, and that's a blessing. Raymond loved and cherished his wife, Angie. I don't know if y'all know, but Andrew sacrificed and worked tirelessly to take care of Ray in his sickness. When she herself needed medical attention, when she should have had an operation a few days ago, to best I understand, but she sacrificed herself to be there for him and love him and to do what he needed. So keep her in your prayers as she is looking to have some more medical stuff done. He loves his two smart and hardworking sons, Johnny and Cody. I know personally he was very proud of both of them. He felt blessed to have been a part of their lives. And then there's a special blessing of three grandchildren. And those of you that are grandparents will know what I'm talking about there. You gotta be a grandparent to really understand that grandchildren are the best thing since sliced bread, folks. I often say they're your reward for not killing your children when they're teenagers, because sometimes you want to. He loved those people. As many of you know, though, the grandkids just get that little special place in your heart you didn't even know you had before they were born, and all of a sudden it's right there. It's right there. We all have stories to tell about Raymond, but I remember several times when I worked at Turner's and worked with Miss Virginia, and we come up with a need. There was a storm brewing and coming into the coast, and we didn't have but one or two generators. When you people in the community needed them, she'd make a phone call up to Norfolk. After work, he'd go by the warehouse and pick up all he could get in his truck or on a trailer or whatever he had and bring them so people here would have power if we had outages through the storm. Sometimes it was just getting ready for a Christmas parade that he came and worked side by side with us tirelessly for nothing but just the joy of doing it. Sometimes we got him just to stop by that warehouse to bring us a little dirt bike to make a kid's birthday or a kid's Christmas, just because we didn't have it right then and the birthday was right there. One phone call and he was right there for us. I think y'all have had times like that when he was right there for you when you needed him to be, when you wanted him to be. I did hear one story how that late one night after being out with some buddies, he came home and I think it was a friend named Melvin. They came in and decided to cook some French fries. Well, the way I heard the story, and I think that's just right, they decided to cook these French fries, and by some impairment of judgment, they did everything right except turn the fry daddy on. So they waited a little while, and they went back to get their French fries and enjoyed some of the coldest, hardest, greasiest French fries you've ever seen in your life, as if they were the best French fries ever. Virginia said it made them both sick. I wonder if it was French fries. But there are many more memories that will go on forever in your hearts and your mind of the time you spent with Raymond Lee, or Sugar Bear, however you want to call him. Johnny has some testimony, some words he'd like to say. He's going to come up now and share with us. And then I'll be back.
My dad adopted me when I was 5 years old. He taught me everything I know about sports, work, and girls. From UNC to the Braves, we were the same. The only difference was when it came to his beloved Cowboys. We had many a day and playful arguments over who was better between them and the Eagles. I remember going on family vacations to see the Braves play, where we would stop at south of the border. We had some great times when I was growing up. He would coach me in Little League, even when I didn't want him to, because I knew he would be tougher on me than anybody else on that team. I look back now and realize he only did that out of love and wanting to see me succeed. I remember watching him play softball and remember thinking how I wanted to be just like him, pitching and hitting bombs. I think I did pretty well at the pitching part, but man, I could never hit it like he could. The joy he got out of the game, whether it was playing or umpiring, was unmatched. I still remember the phone call I got from him the day Cody was born. I said to him, "Dude, I'm finally out of the house. And now you're starting it all over again. But then I met you. And I could tell why. You lit his world on fire. He was so proud of you, Cody. His Cody bear. Believe me when I say this. He loved you, Cody. And was proud of the man you are becoming. Angie, stay strong. I know he loved you with all his heart. Granny, be the rock that he always knew you were, the figurehead of the family. Dad and I used to have a little inside joke. He would say, what do you get when you cross an HVAC tech with a banker? Well, another HVAC tech. Well, that one came true, and I hope I made you proud. Rest easy, Pops. I love you. Till we meet again.
No truer words have ever been spoken. Many folks sitting in here today, and you may not have realized, Raymond Lee had a lot of wealth, and he left y'all something. He had a ton of memories, and he left some of them with each and every one of you. A treasure you can carry on the rest of your lives. Treasure those memories, hold them dear to your heart, and never, ever turn loose of them. You know, that is what Raymond Lee left for you. Many of us don't know that he lived the past part, is a part of the last part of his life, on only about 9% of his heart, even working. There was some times there that he survived with 9% of his heart working when others didn't even realize it. Now, I would think, and my thinking there, I'd say if it was a little bitty heart, 9% of it wouldn't be enough. See, Lee had a great big old heart. 9% of it was enough to keep him going. I know some things about Raymond Lee's heart. And I know that in his heart there was a love for his family and for his friends. I also know that this past Sunday morning, Raymond Lee met God face to face. And I also know that right now, if he could say one thing to each and every one of you, if he could speak to you today, he would tell you this, that you too will meet God face to face. And the only way that you'll be admitted into his heaven was by the acceptance of Jesus Christ as your Lord. He would say, so please prepare yourself for your eternity with the Lordship of Jesus before you meet God. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. ponder that. Raymond Lee recently retired from Norfolk Naval Base, where he worked about 35 years as an HVAC tech. That's a long time, folks, to be in one place. Not many people do that anymore. It takes dedication. This beloved man, who was like us, far from perfect, was loved and cherished by many, many friends and family. We will miss him, but we know that he is not gone. He just moved to another home. He just moved, and he awaits us there. I many times relate to people just to help some understanding and a little bit more of the terms that gets us, you know, is imagine yourself traveling through life on a bus. And one day the bus has a flat tire and you get it fixed. Another day it starts making a little noise and it goes to the shop and you get it fixed. Well, you go through life, and as that bus gets older and older, you have more and more trouble with it. Well, one day the old bus just up and quits. And you say, what am I going to do now? But as you walk out the door of the bus, there stands Jesus, and he said, come on, ride with me. That's the way it is, folks. That's the way it is. This old bus going to quit, but Jesus ain't. The last part of our service today will be a Masonic rites ceremony. Raymond Lee was a longtime member of the Masonic Lodge and held the rank of past master. His brothers there knew and loved him greatly also. Following this next song, we'll ask our friends, the Masons, to come and hold a ceremony honoring Raymond Lee. When they are finished, the service will conclude. The family will be out in the lobby for a few minutes if you'd like to speak with them. But as you listen to this next song, imagine how Raymond Lee felt when he saw Jesus face to face this past Sunday morning. Then imagine how you will react when you see him. Let's have prayer and we'll get the music. Father, we thank you that you have tabernacled, stayed, lived, mingled with us today. We thank you, Lord, for your peace, for your comfort, for your unfailing love. And we thank you that we can have an eternity with you. Lord, we thank you for Raymond Lee, for all he meant to each and every one of us, for the mark he made on this world and on those sons and on that family. Lord, we pray that his legacy would live on and would bring you glory. Lord, we give the rest of this service to you also. We look forward to what you're going to do with that. And we give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. For all you're going to do with this family in the coming days as you comfort them through this time of loss and through this getting used to life without this dearly beloved one. We love you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. In Christ's holy name, amen.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine, yeah. I can only imagine. Forever, forever worship you. I can only
time immemorial, it has been the custom of the fraternity of ancient free and accepted masons, upon request, to accompany the body of a deceased brother to the place of interment, and there to deposit it with due formalities. In conformity to this ancient usage, we have assembled to offer this last tribute of esteem, to express our sincere affection for our departed brother, and to reaffirm our steady attachment to the principles of freedom. As we bid farewell to the mortal body and Godspeed to the immortal spirit of him who came into our fraternity of his own free will and accord and who dwelt a brother among us, we observe a ceremony not of bitter grief, but of faith, not of despair, but of hope. These last rites we accord our brother signify our parting with his physical body, from which his immortal spirit already has achieved release. We thus perform them serenely, supported by our knowledge that because of the uncertainties of human life, each of us in his time must follow the pathway our brother's soul has taken. Thus men cannot labor or live always. Today our brother answers not our call. We shall no more hear his voice until we shall have answered another world, the voice that has called him. Let us then, not mourning as those who have no hope, pay the last sad offices of pious duty to our departed brother, These ceremonies cannot profit him. He is beyond the reach of honor and censure alike. To us, the living, they may and should be prophets. They comfort those whom he loved. They show our appreciation of his virtues and his work. They encourage others to labor and endeavor to deserve the honors we pay to him. And they further demonstrate that the ties, sympathies, and obligations of our fraternity cannot be broken by the hand of death. This assembly then should awaken serious reflection and strengthen our resolution for the future. Let us embrace the present moment, and now, while time and opportunity are ours, make sure the preparation for the coming day, when the reflections consequent on a well-spent life will afford us comfort and consolation. Let faith be the foundation of our hope, and charity the fruit of our obedience to his will, that we may receive death as a kind messenger, sent from our supreme Grand Master to translate us from this imperfect to that all-perfect, glorious, and celestial lodge above, where the supreme architect of the universe resides. The lambskin or white leather apron is the emblem of innocence and the badge of a mason, more ancient than the golden fleece or Roman eagle, more honorable than the star and garter when worldly worn. An apron was presented our brother on his first admission into the lodge. At that time, he was informed that it was his to wear throughout an honorable life, and at his death to be placed upon the coffin which should contain his earthly remains, and with them laid beneath the silent clods of the valley. Accordingly, I now place this apron upon the coffin of our deceased brother. By this, we are reminded of the universal dominion of death. The arm of friendship cannot oppose the hand of death, nor the charms of innocence elude its grasp. The grave, this coffin, this circle of mourning friends remind us that we too are mortal. Soon shall our bodies mold to dust. This evergreen is a symbol of our belief and an emblem of our faith in the immortality of the soul. By it we are reminded that we have an immortal part within us, which shall survive the grave, and which shall never, never, never die. Brethren, join me in giving the funeral grand honors. The will of God accomplished, so mote it be. Amen. The will of God accomplished, so mote it be. Amen. We cherish his memory here. We commend his spirit unto God who gave it, and commit his body to the tomb. Unto the grave we consign the body of our deceased brother, there to remain until the trumpet shall sound on the resurrection morn. We can cheerfully leave him in the hands of a being who has done all things well, who is glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders. Soft and safe, my brother, be your earthly bed. Bright and beautiful be your rising from it. With fragrance eternal may the sprig of acacia here flourish, and here the sweetness of the summer's last rose linger longest. Though the cold blasts of winter may lay them in the dust, and for a time destroy their loveliness, their fading is not final. In the springtime, they shall surely bloom again. So, my brother, in the bright morning of the world's resurrection, your mortal frame now laid in the dust shall come again into newness of life and expand in immortal beauty and realms beyond the skies. Until then, my brother, until then, farewell. Father, in your gracious keeping, leave we now our brother sleeping. To those of the immediate relatives and friends who are most heart-stricken at the loss they have sustained, we extend our sincere and most affectionate sympathy. May your faith in our Heavenly Father bring you peace and hope. Our consoling thought is one of thankfulness to the great Creator for our brother's life, the contemplation of which should inspire us to emulate his many lovable qualities and virtues, so that on the great day of account, we may receive from the compassionate judge the welcome invitation. Come, children of the Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, and before whom all men must appear in the judgment day to give an account of their deeds in life, we who now surround the coffin of our deceased brother most earnestly beseech you to impress deeply on our minds the solemnities of this day. Look with infinite compassion upon the bereaved in their hour of desolation. Bless them with your love and protection. May they find consolation and peace in the assurance that their loved one, our friend and brother, has entered into a higher brotherhood to engage in nobler duties. And may we have your divine assistance, O merciful God, that when our work here on earth is done, our souls, disengaged from their comfort steps, may flourish and bloom in eternal day, there to enjoy the rest which you have prepared for all good and faithful servants in that spiritual temple, that house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. The everlasting arms protect and guide us in the path of righteousness. May the light of the Father's welcome transfigure us on the morn of the endless day.